from 1923, and coincidentally, Opus 23. This happens very frequently in the course of Schoenberg's writing, that is, opus numbers correspond to the year in which they're written. So here we have Opus 23, written in 1923, in which all 12 tones are presented in a pre-established order or series, with no single tone repeated until all other 11 have been sounded. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Now this is the ground rule of the whole system. It's vastly oversimplified, naturally, but we haven't got all night to, or all week, to teach you the 12-tone system. But that is the basic ground rule, which serves to give each of the 12 tones its equal rights. It's like establishing a pure democracy among them. Now, of course, the piece doesn't begin with a naked presentation of that 12-tone set, or row, as it's called. Tone row, that's the usual term. Any more than the Moonlight Sonata begins with the presentation of the C-sharp minor scale. The first thing actually heard in the piece is a transformation of the row, with certain of its notes combined into chords and others used as melody. In other words, a surface structure has been evolved. Now you look at those first two bars and you can see that all the 12 tones are present. Now once this row has been presented in its first transformational form, it's immediately heard again, but in a new order. That is, the series has now undergone a permutation. Now, these permutations of the row continue in always new ways, in new melodic, harmonic, and rhythmic combinations, which we might well call, in our now familiar linguistic terms, transformations of transformations. It's a kind of perpetual variation, or metamorphosis. And all of this, through Schoenberg's inventive genius, becomes a piece with the unexpectedly simple title of Waltz. And it goes like this, as you know. This history-making little waltz may not sound so very different to you in its non-tonal style from the earlier examples I played you of free atonality. But there's all the difference in the world. This piece is strictly controlled by its consistent adherence to the original set of 12 tones. Oops, sorry, missed that one. In a sense, that tone row performs something like the function of a scale in tonal music. That is, to provide a basic source of underlying strings, as the linguists would say, evolving into a deep structure of musical prose, so to speak, out of which this ultimate surface structure arises. Now, of course, there are lots of other rules of serial music which have a similar goal of democratizing the 12 tones. For instance, the extreme top or bottom note of a melodic line automatically acquires extra importance because of its position, right? And that's not democratic. Likewise, a note that lasts longer than its neighbors will seem more important owing to its extra duration. And so there are compensatory rules that require the extreme highs or lows of a line to be of especially short duration, which prevents them from getting too much attention. And conversely, long-lasting notes must never be at the very top or the very bottom. These rules, you have to understand, are not rigid. They are suggested rules And Schoenberg always made these rules only to be broken. He was the first one to break them himself, and he was the first one to tell his composition students, don't compose in my method, learn my method, and then just compose. All great men are their own rule breakers, from Plato through Stravinsky, Nietzsche, and everybody else. So, to the extent that the row does provide certain functions analogous to those of a scale in the tonal system, this 12-tone or dodecaphonic method is indeed a viable replacement for tonal composition. And it was such a welcome gift to the crisis-ridden 20th century composer that it took instant stronghold, capturing the imagination of such composers as Alban Berg and Anton von Webern, both ardent Schoenberg disciples, and persisting to this very day, with evolutionary modifications, of course, in the music of Stockhausen, Boulez, Warenin, Kirchner, Babbitt, Voss, Berio, and sometimes me, though very rarely. It's as though a new covenant had been formed, replacing the old one of tonality. Think of that. If we think of tonality as a kind of grammatical covenant or agreement that there will be sentences in speech, then certain rules have to be obeyed. Only recall Alice's bemused sentence, do cats eat bats? Remember Alice in Wonderland? Now that's a puzzled but valid sentence. And then she wonders immediately after, do bats eat cats? Now it's a semantic change, but it's still grammatically valid, right? But if we invert the sentence by reversing its order, we get bats eat cats do, which is meaningless and chaotic. It's as though we took the opening phrase of the Blue Danube Waltz, right, and inverted it into this. It's weak, though it's still acceptable. It's just lousy. Maybe we could even call it a metaphor and get away with it. But if we invert the second phrase, we're in chaos. It's cats and bats again. Now, of course, that last phrase is conceivable as what used to be called crazy modern music. Just as eat, do, cats, bats is conceivable as a line of crazy modern poetry. But in both cases, there is an obvious crisis in syntax. A new system of controls is clearly needed, a new covenant that will guarantee order. Trouble is that the new musical rules of Schoenberg are not based on innate awareness, on the intuition of tonal relationships. They're like rules of an artificial language, though hopefully a universal language, and so all such rules must be deliberately learned. And this would seem to lead to what used to be called form without content in the field of aesthetics, or structuralism for its own sake. That's exactly what Schoenberg is accused of, for example, in the Soviet Union. Formalism, they call it there, and it's strictly forbidden to the Soviet composer. But we know that Schoenberg never meant anything of the kind. He was just too musical to hold such an attitude, too much of a music lover. And no matter how much emphasis he placed on logical structure, that structure is still derived from the same 12 tones of the harmonic series, a universal we all share. And this fact alone would account for Schoenberg's constant reversions to tonality, whether overt or implied, as well as his reversion to traditional syntactic structures, even in the same Opus 23 waltz we were just hearing, where the serial system is being displayed for the first time in history, we find a passage such as this with a perfectly symmetrical sequence. Listen to this. Now that's three bars, which is then repeated in exact sequence. Exact sequence. And not only is that passage symmetrical, but there hangs over it a strong feeling of tonality. Do you sense that tonal quality, those perfect fifths in the melodic line? And then And do you sense the dominant feeling in the accompaniment? You hear that? And the next bar? That dominant quality. And this kind of tonal feeling haunted Schoenberg's music and still haunts it right up to the end of his life.